In the second part, we will study about the radial nerve. Radial nerve is a branch from the posterior cord. This is the radial nerve arising from the posterior cord. Radial nerve is present in the axilla region. Then it descends down the arm related to the spiral groove of humerus. Spiral groove is also called as radial groove. Here the nerve is intimately related to the humerus bone. If in case there is a fracture of humerus at the spiral groove level in the middle part of the humerus, then the nerve will also get damaged. Next, the nerve comes in the cubital fossa and it divides in cubital fossa into two branches. One is the deep branch, which enters into the supinator muscle, and as it emerges from the supinator muscle lower down, it is known as the posterior intraosseous nerve. The superficial branch continues to supply the skin in the hand. In the side figure, the line diagram shows the roots from which the radial nerve gets its fibers. So all the roots of the brachial plexus C5, 6, 7, 8 and T1, they all contribute fibers to the radial nerve. In the axilla, the first branch arising from the radial nerve is the lateral cutaneous nerve of arm. It also supplies medial head and long head of triceps from the axilla itself. In the arm, this is the branches arising from in the arm. So we have cutaneous branch, lateral cutaneous nerve of arm, then the muscular branches for remaining part of the triceps, anconius, brachialis, brachioradialis, extensor carpi radialis longus, and the elbow joint. There is also a cutaneous branch, posterior cutaneous nerve of forearm, which arises in the spiral groove itself. In the forearm, the nerve is having two branches. Superficial branch of the radial nerve is cutaneous and it supplies the skin over the dorsum of the hand and 3.5 lateral finger on the back side. Then the muscles supplied are the extensor carpi radialis brevis, abductor pollicis longus, supinator, extensor digitorum, extensor digiti minimi, extensor carpi ulnaris, abductor pollicis longus, extensor pollicis longus, extensor pollicis brevis and extensor indicis. These are the muscles which are supplied by the deep branch or the posterior interosseous nerve. So these are the branches coming from the radial nerve. Next, we will see what happens if there is injury to the radial nerve. Radial nerve, if it is injured at different levels, different set of findings would be there. So first we will see what happens if radial nerve is injured at axilla. Mode of injury will be badly fitting crutches, putting pressure on the radial nerve. Then sometimes people tend to sleep over the chair with axilla over the armrest. This is called a Saturday night palsy, when people take drinks in Saturday because it's weekend. They under the effect of drinks, they tend to fall asleep on the chair itself. Then if there is inferior dislocation of the shoulder joint, then also there are chances that radial nerve will get damaged. The muscles which will lose supply if the radial nerve is damaged at the level of the axilla are triceps. All the heads of the triceps will be affected because all the branches for the triceps are arising at this level. Then the all other muscles which are supplied lower down by the radial nerve, like anconius, brachioradialis, extensor carpi radialis longus, extensor carpi radialis brevis, supinator, and all other muscles supplied by the posterior intraosseous nerve, they all will be affected. So most of the extensors are affected. That will leave the wrist as flexed, because the flexors will be unopposed and they will flex the wrist. Then supinator is also affected. That will leave the pronator muscles unopposed and the arm, the wrist will be pronated. This position is known as wrist drop and can be seen in the figure. The hand will be just hanging like this. There will not be any extensor acting to extend the wrist as well as the fingers. So fingers would also be slightly flexed. In this position, although the flexors are working, so a person can grab a thing, but he will be finding difficulty in making a very strong fist, because to make a strong fist we have to first extend and then we make the strong fist. If the arm is flexed like this, the strength is not there in the fist. So this is about the motor loss and the wrist drop. The sensory loss will also be seen. The arm supplied by the posterior cutaneous nerve of the arm, this region, and the posterior cutaneous nerve of the forearm, all this area will lose its supply, as well as the dorsum of the skin and lateral 3.5 fingers, this also will lose its supply. And very important to note is at the base of the thumb, this area is although on the palmar side but still supplied by the radial nerve. So this pink small area, that also will lose its sensation. So this was all what will happen if the radial nerve is injured at the level of axilla. Next we will see the effect of injury to radial nerve at the level of the spiral groove in the middle of the arm. So at the level of the spiral groove, usually radial nerve is injured by the fracture of the humerus, which occurs at the level of the spiral groove. And the radial nerve is injured at the lower part of the spiral groove. So in this type of injury, the nerves which have already arose from the radial nerve in the axilla, they will not be affected. So the nerves which already branched out from the radial nerve in the axilla, where the nerves which are going to the medial head and the long head of the triceps, as well as in the upper part, the posterior cutaneous nerve had already taken origin. So these posterior cutaneous nerve of the arm, which arose in the axilla, and forearm, which arose in the upper part of the spiral groove, they will be again spared, not affected by the injury. Now remaining all other muscles which we have discussed previously, the muscles which are supplied by the posterior intraosseous nerve, as well as the skin supplied by the superficial branch of the radial nerve, they will be paralyzed. So in this type of injury, elbow extension will be preserved. Okay, so this will remain normal, while the extensors acting on the fingers and the wrist, they will be affected. So person will still have the wrist drop as seen in the picture. So elbow is working normally, but wrist drop will still be there. Sensory loss again will be only limited to the hand. So this pink portion and this pink portion at the base of the thumb, these areas will lose sensation. The other pink portion which we had seen in the previous slides in this region, this is also supplied by the radial nerve, but as I told you, the cutaneous nerve for this region is the posterior cutaneous nerve of forearm, which already arises from the upper part of the spiral groove and will not be affected. So this is about the injury to the radial nerve in the spiral groove. Then we come on to the next part, injury to the branches of the radial nerve. So there are two branches, deep branch of the radial nerve and the superficial branch. So what will happen to the deep branch? deep branch, as I told you, we can see in this figure, the deep branch of the radial nerve is shown here. It disappears from the cubital fossa. It is seen and it disappears into the supinator muscle. It passes through the supinator muscle, and when it comes out, it is seen in the posterior or the extensor part of the forearm, and then it is known as the posterior intraosseous nerve. So this nerve can get injured in the fracture or dislocation of the upper end of the radius, or as it passes through the supinator, it can get injured in its pathway as it passes through the supinator and the lateral intermuscular septum of the forearm. This thing is called as the radial tunnel syndrome. So in this case, the muscles which will lose their supply will be the muscles supplied by the posterior intraosseous nerve. These are the extensors to the fingers and the extensors to the wrist. The finger extension will be lost. But in this case, what is happening? The extensor carpi radialis longus, extensor carpi radialis brevis, they are normal. So there will not be any wrist drop and they will hold the wrist in its position. Also, this nerve is a pure motor nerve. It is not supplying any part of the skin. So there will not be any sensory loss as well. Next is the effect of injury to the superficial branch of the radial nerve. Superficial branch, we have to know that it is not supplying any muscle, so there will not be any motor loss, only sensory loss would be there, and this sensory loss will be limited in the hand. So we can see the superficial branch of the radial nerve, which is supplying this portion, the 3.5 fingers on the dorsum, or in the figure you can see this pink area here and a small pink area at the base of the thumb. So this portion of the hand will lose its supply. In this figure we can see the superficial branch of the radial nerve passing here. So this is the place where the superficial branch can be seen. This nerve can be injured by the superficial cuts because it is quite superficial, especially in the anatomical snuff box. If there is a superficial cut, then this nerve can get injured. So this is all about the injury to the radial nerve and its branches.